that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus,
Son of Man, must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and rise on the third day.
Telling each of them, do not lose hope.
Dear brothers and sisters, on this most sacred night, in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed over from death to life, the Church calls upon her sons and daughters scattered throughout the world to come together to watch and pray. If we keep the memorial of the Lord's Paschal solemnity in this way, listening to his word and celebrating his mysteries, then we shall have the sure hope of sharing his triumph over death and living with him in God. And the blessing of the fire. First. Faithful, the fire of your glory. Sanctify this new fire, we pray, and grant that by these paschal celebrations we may be so inflamed with heavenly desires that with minds made pure we may attain festivities of unending splendor through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
As we focus our attention on our new Easter candle, please echo the following responses after me. Christ, yesterday and today.
Christ, yesterday and today.
The beginning and the end.
The beginning and the end.
The Alpha and the Omega.
The Alpha and the Omega.
All time belongs to him.
All time belongs to him.
And all the ages.
And all the ages.
To him be glory and power.
To him be glory and power.
Through every age and forever, amen.
Through every age and forever, amen.
By his holy and glorious wounds.
By his holy and glorious wounds.
May Christ the Lord guard us and protect us. Amen.
May Christ the Lord guard us and protect us. Amen.
May the light of Christ, rising in glory, dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds.
As we follow the light of Christ into the church, please stay behind the light of Christ as we enter the church so that it's apparent how the light of Christ is what spreads God's light among us.
Thank you. Barb, may the Lord be in your heart and on your lips, that you may worthily announce the Easter proclamation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Rejoice, heavenly powers, sing choirs of angels, exalt all creation around God's throne. Jesus Christ, our King, is risen. Sound the trumpet of salvation. Rejoice, O earth, in shining splendor, radiant in the brightness of your King. Christ has conquered, glory fills you. Darkness vanishes forever. Rejoice, O Mother Earth, exult in glory. The risen Savior shines upon you. Let this place resound with joy, echoing the mighty song of all God's people. My dearest friends, standing with me in this holy light, join me in asking God for mercy, that he may give his unworthy minister grace to sing his praises. It is truly right and just that with full hearts and mind and voices, we should praise the unseen God, the all-powerful Father, and his only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. For Christ has ransomed us with his blood and paid for us the price of Adam's sin to our eternal Father. This is the night, it is the Passover feast, when Christ the true Lamb is slain, whose blood conquers the homes of all believers. This is the night when first you saved our fathers and freed the people of Israel from slavery and led them dry shod through the sea. This is the night when the pillar of fire destroyed the darkness of sin. This is the night when Christians everywhere, washed clean of sin and freed from all defilement, are restored to grace and grow together in holiness. This is the night when Jesus Christ broke the chains of death and rose triumphant from the grave. What good would life have been to us had Christ not come and become our Redeemer? Father, how wonderful your care for us, how boundless your merciful love. To ransom a slave, you gave away your only Son. Oh, happy fault, oh, necessary sin of Adam, which gained for us so great a Redeemer. Most blessed of all now, chosen by God to see Christ risen from the dead. Of this night, Scripture says, the night will be as clear as day. It will become our light, my joy. Accept this Easter candle. May it always dispel the darkness of this night. May the morning star, which never sets, find this flame still burning. Christ, that morning star, who came back from the dead and shed his peaceful light on humankind. Your Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Please extinguish your candles and just keep them upright for a moment so the wax can harden. My dear brothers and sisters, now that we have begun our solemn vigil, let us listen with quiet hearts to the Word of God. Let us meditate on how God, in times past, saved his people, and in these, the last days, has sent us his Son as our Redeemer. Let us pray that our God may complete this paschal work of salvation by the fullness of redemption.
A proclamation from the book of Genesis. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless wasteland, and darkness covered the abyss, while a mighty wind swept over the waters. Then God said,
"Let there be light."
And there was light. God saw how good the light was. God then separated the light from the darkness. God called the first light day, and the darkness he called night. Thus evening came, and morning followed, the first day. Then God said,
"Let there be a dome in the middle of the waters to separate one body of water from the other."
And so it happened. God made the dome, and it separated the water above the dome from the water below it. God called the dome the sky. Evening came, and morning followed, the second day. Then God said,
"Let the water under the sky be gathered into a single basin, so that the dry land may appear."
And so it happened. The water under the sky was gathered into the basin, and the dry land appeared. God called the dry land the earth, and the basin of water he called the sea. God saw how good it was. Then God said,
"Let the earth bring forth vegetation, every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on earth that bears fruit with its seed in it."
And so it happened. The earth brought forth every kind of plant that bears seed, and every kind of fruit tree on the earth that bears fruit with seed in it. God saw how good it was. Evening came, morning followed, the third day. Then God said,
"Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate day from night. Let them mark the first times, the days and the years, and serve as luminaries in the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth."
And so it happened. God made the two great lights, the greater one to govern the day and the lesser one to govern the night. And he made the stars. God sent them into the dome of the sky to shed light upon the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. God saw how good it was. Evening came and morning followed, the fourth day. Then God said,
"Let the water teem with an abundance of living creatures, and on the earth let birds fly beneath the dome of the sky."
And so it happened. God created the great sea monsters and all kinds of swimming creatures with which the water teems, and all kinds of winged birds. God saw how good it was, and God blessed them, saying,
"Be fertile, multiply, and fill the water of the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth."
Evening came, and morning followed, the fifth day. Then God said,
"Let the earth bring forth all kinds of living creatures, cattle, creeping things, and wild animals of all kinds."
And so it happened. God made all kinds of wild animals, all kinds of cattle, and all kinds of creeping things on the earth. God saw how good it was. Then God said,
"Let us make people in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the seas, the birds of the air, and the cattle, and over all the wild animals and all creatures that crawl on the ground."
God created people in his image. In the divine image, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, saying,
"Be fertile and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and all the living things that move on the earth."
God also said,
"See, I give you every seed-bearing plant all over the earth, and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit on it to be your food, and all the animals of the land, all the birds of the air, and all the living creatures that crawl on the ground. I give all the green plants for food."
And so it happened. God looked at everything he had made, and he found it very good. Evening came, and morning followed, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the array were completed. Since on the seventh day, God was finished with the work he had been doing, he rested on the seventh day from all of the work he had undertaken. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who are wonderful in the ordering of all your works, may those you have redeemed understand that there exists nothing more marvelous than the world's creation in the beginning, except that at the end of the ages, Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
A proclamation from the book of Exodus.
The Lord said to Moses,
"Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward and lift up your staff, and with hand outstretched over the sea, split the sea in two, that the Israelites may pass through it on dry land. But I will make the Egyptians so obstinate that they will go in after them. Then I will receive glory through Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and charioteers. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I receive glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and charioteers."
God, who had been leading Israel's camp, now moved and went around behind them. The column of cloud also, leaving the front, took up its place behind them, so that it came between the camp of the Egyptians and that of Israel. But the cloud now became dark, and thus the night passed without the rival camps coming any closer together all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea with a strong east wind throughout the night, and so turned it into dry land. When the water was thus divided, the Israelites marched into the midst of the sea on dry land, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. The Egyptians followed in pursuit. All Pharaoh's horses and chariots and charioteers went after them right into the midst of the sea. In the night watch, just before dawn, The Lord cast through the column of the fiery cloud upon the Egyptian force a glance that threw it into a panic. And he so clogged their chariot wheels that they could hardly drive. With that, the Egyptians sounded the retreat before Israel, because the Lord was fighting for them against the Egyptians.
Then the Lord told Moses, "Stretch your hand out over the sea, that the water may flow back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and charioteers."
Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn, the sea flowed back to its normal depth. The Egyptians were fleeing head on toward the sea when the Lord hurled them into its midst. The water flowed back. It covered the chariots and the charioteers of Pharaoh's whole army, which had followed the Egyptians into the sea. Not a single one of them escaped. But the Israelites had marched on dry land through the midst of the sea, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel on that day from the power of the Egyptians. When Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the seashore and beheld the great power that the Lord had shown against the Egyptians, they feared the Lord and believed in him and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. O God, whose ancient wonders remain undimmed in splendor even in our day, for what you once bestowed on a single people, freeing them from Pharaoh's persecution by the power of your right hand. Now you bring about as the salvation of the nations through the waters of rebirth. Grant, we pray, that the whole world may become children of Abraham and inherit the dignity of Israel's birthright. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A proclamation from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, all you who are thirsty, come to the water. You who have no money, come, receive grain and eat. Come, without paying and without cost. Drink wine and milk. Why spend your money for what is not bread, your wages for what fails to satisfy? Heed me, and you shall eat well. You shall delight in rich fare. Come to me heedfully. Listen, that you may have life. I will renew with you the everlasting covenant, the benefits assured to David, as I made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander of nations. So shall you summon a nation you do not know, and nations that do not know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, who has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way and the wicked man his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God who is generous in forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. For just as from the heavens the rain and snow come down and do not return there till they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to those who sow and bread to those who eat, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, sole hope of the world, who by the preaching of your prophets unveiled the mysteries of this present age, graciously increase the longing of your people, for only at the prompting of your grace do the faithful progress in any kind of virtue. Through Christ our Lord.
A proclamation from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, when the house of Israel lived in their land, they defiled it by their conduct and deeds. Therefore, I poured out my fury on them because of the blood that they poured on the ground, and because they defiled it with idols. I scattered them among the nations, dispersing them all over foreign lands. According to their conduct and deeds, I judged them. But when they came among the nations, wherever they came, they served to profane my holy name, because it was said of them, These are the people of the Lord, yet they had to leave their land. So I relented because of my holy name, which the house of Israel profaned. Therefore, say to the house of Israel, Thus says the Lord God, Not for your sake do I ask, but the house of Israel, but for the sake of my holy name I act, which you have profaned among the nations to which you came. I will prove the holiness of my great name, in whose midst you have profaned it. Thus the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God. When in their sight, I prove my holiness through you. For I will take you away from among the nations, gather you all from their foreign lands, and bring you back to your land. I will sprinkle clean water on you to cleanse you from all your impurities. And from all of the idols, I will cleanse you. I will give you a new heart and place a new spirit within you, taking from your bodies the hearts cold and giving you natural hearts. I will put my spirit within you and make you live by my statutes, careful to observe my decrees. You shall live in the land I gave your fathers. You shall be my people, and I shall be your God. The word of our Lord.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O God of unchanging power and eternal light, look with favor on the wondrous mystery of the whole church, and serenely accomplish the work of human salvation, which you planned from all eternity. May the whole world know and see that what was cast down is raised up, what had become old is made new, and all things are restored to integrity through Christ, just as by him they came into being, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who makes this most sacred night radiant with the glory of the Lord's resurrection, stir up in your church a spirit of adoption, so that renewed in body and mind, we may render you undivided service. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A proclamation from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Are you unaware, brothers and sisters, that we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in newness of life. For if we have grown into union with him through a death like his, we shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that our sinful body might be done away with, that we might no longer be in slavery to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If then we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
My sisters and brothers, the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
At daybreak, on the first day of the week, the women who had come from Galilee with Jesus took spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were puzzling over this, two men in dazzling garments appeared to them. They were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. The men said to them, "Why do you seek the living one among the dead? He is not here. He has been raised. Remember what he said to you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and rise on the third day." And then they remembered the words. They returned from the tomb and they announced all these things to the 11 and to the others. The women were Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James. The others who accompanied them also told this to the apostles. But to the apostles, their story seemed like nonsense, and they did not believe them. Then Peter got up and he ran to the tomb, bent down, and he saw the burial cloths. He went home amazed at what had happened.
For this good news, let us pray to the Lord.
Seventh inning stretch. It struck me at the beginning of this liturgy how blessed I feel to be a part of this community of faith. My first Christmas here, I made some comment about how happy I was to be here, and then after Mass, one of the gentlemen came up to me and said, "Wait till Easter. You haven't seen anything yet." And now my second experience of your celebration of the resurrection of the Lord. I've been asked to extend a very special wish for a blessed and happy Easter to all of you and to our entire community of faith of St. James. And the person who wanted to extend this special wish to all of you really would prefer to be here in person to wish that to you, but he's sitting in the Waukesha County Jail. The past few weeks, I've been visiting a young man, 24 years old, in the Waukesha County Jail. Just enjoyable to get to know. Very bright, very energetic, wonderful personality, but because of some difficult things in the course of his years, he's there once again. And it helped me connect a little bit with the inspiring gesture that I think many of us saw with our new
Pope Francis on Holy Thursday when he went to the jail in Rome and washed the feet of 12 of the inmates at the jail in Rome, and even kissed the feet of each inmate. Thursday, I washed Deacon Mike Rooney's feet. I'm sorry, Mike, though, I didn't kiss your feet. But how inspiring, the Pope kissing the feet of inmates. How inspiring to see him on his hands and knees washing their feet. Isn't that the Jesus that has captivated our imaginations, that has drawn us into this way of life, that has drawn us into being baptized, into his dying and rising? The Jesus that gets down and washes feet. How awesome. That's now the leader of our universal church. And it provides echoes of the person he chose to name his papacy after, Francis of Assisi. St. Francis was disgusted by the lepers of his day. He would go out of his way to avoid the lepers of his day. And yet, as his journey of faith unfolded, he began to discover that the lepers were the face of Christ for him. And Francis embraced the lepers. Those who disgusted him now became the source of great joy. And so he embraced the lepers and kissed them. We're getting the impression that that's the sort of tone our new Pope is setting for the future direction of our faith community, a tone of service, a tone of embracing those on the fringe. And how inspiring his word of message to them, as I read in the news, telling each of them, do not lose hope. Do not lose hope. How important it is to have a sense of hope. And I've been gaining a certain sense of that as I visit this young man in the Waukesha County Jail. He's hoping that this is his last time that he has to spend in jail. He'll be released in mid-May. He's hoping to find a new set of friends. He's hoping to pursue his desire to learn how to weld and to earn a respectful living by being a welder. He's hoping for a future that up to now has eluded him. Just as Pope Francis told those prisoners outside of Rome, do not lose hope. This young man, I could sense, has a sense of hope. It was in his eyes, in his voice, and that he would extend himself to wish all of you a blessed and joyous Easter. This really is the source of our hope, the dying and the rising of Christ. I imagine if you're like me, there are times when hope escapes us, when we feel overwhelmed by the sadness and the violence and the tragedy in our world as we look on the news, or perhaps in our personal lives or among our extended family. At times, hope can elude us. We can lose hope. And yet, the event that we are celebrating this evening restores hope. The good news that Jesus has entrusted to all of us, the good news that we are immersed into by our baptism, is the good news that our God extends us hope. And though at times, perhaps in the short run, it seems like hope is lost, our celebration tonight reminds us that our God fulfills God's promises. Our God enkindles within us hope, like that beautiful Easter fire, enkindled brightness and warmth and new life. We come together to celebrate the hope that we have from the dying and the rising of Jesus, and the hope you and I are empowered to bring to the world that at times seems so very hopeless. We might summarize the good news of Jesus Christ in three very simple ways. First of all, God accepts you and me just as we are. We don't have to clean ourselves up. We don't have to do so much penance. so much restitution. God embraces us as we are, in our faults, our failures, our sins. We focused on that through these past 40 days of Lent. How powerful that gospel story of Jesus encountering the woman caught in adultery. Is there no one to condemn you? No one, sir. Then neither do I condemn you. Now go and avoid this sin. The first foundation of hope is that God embraces us and accepts you and me just as we are. And the second is that goodness can overcome evil. Goodness can overcome evil. That's a source of hope for you and I when we see so much sadness and sorrow and evil in our world. And the ultimate of all hope, life overcomes death. Life is victorious over death. And not just as we breathe our last, but in the here and now. As we die with Christ, we rise with Christ in our day-to-day lives. Our focus these past 40 days has been living the love of the cross, living that dying with Christ in the here and now, so as to rise with Christ in the here and now. We put that theme to Bishop Skelba at our retreat a few weeks ago with our parish council and pastoral staff. And I was thinking of that theme pretty much in terms of, we live the love of the cross by helping the food pantry, going to repairers of the breach, like perhaps you saw some of our members Holy Thursday on the news, there at the repairers of the breach. We live the love of the cross by our outreach to those in need, the Operation Rice Bowl, so many ways of outreach. But Bishop Skelba said, think about it this way. Think about a dimension in your life that you would make different. You would change if you could. But for some reason, you cannot change it. Accept that as your cross. Accept that as the call to live the love of Christ's cross. And I thought, sure, I've heard that before. That's what the good sisters told me in grade school. That particular cross that we each carry. But where he threw me for a loop, and I couldn't stop thinking of it, he said, then think about that cross that you cannot change and that you are embracing. Think about that cross as a gift. How do I think about that pain in my life that I can't get rid of, that I'd rather be without? How can I think about that as a gift? I've wrestled with that since that retreat. And I think that's part of unpacking what it means to live the love of the cross, to unite our sufferings, our difficulties, our struggles with the cross of Christ, and realize that with the power that comes from Christ crucified, Christ risen, we can come to see how our particular crosses are a gift and how they empower us to further that sense of hope and that presence of God in our world. That's a part of unpacking what it means to live life in Christ, what it means to live our baptism. We've had 40 days to prepare for this night. We now have 50 days to celebrate the Easter mystery, 50 days to unpack what it means to live the love of the cross and to discover in that resurrection, to discover in that the presence and the hope of the risen Lord. And so we celebrate that tonight, renewing our commitment to live the love of the cross that we've embraced through our baptism. It's very common on this night to celebrate the baptism of new members. For this year, we have no one to baptize this evening, so it's an opportunity for us to focus more on renewing our baptism and to welcome a new member into our faith community who has been baptized, who has been living the journey of Christ in his life and has now decided he would like to live that as a member of our faith community. And so we will move now into the blessing of the water of Easter and an opportunity for all of us to renew our baptismal promises, and then with that foundation to welcome Matt Hoffa into our community of faith. And so I invite you, Matt, and your family and friends to come with us to the baptismal font to participate in the blessing of the Easter water and to renew your baptismal commitment with all of us as we are renewed living the love of the cross.
has given us a new birth by water and the Holy Spirit and forgiven all our sins. May He also keep us faithful to our Lord Jesus Christ forever.
Us here gathered around the font will renew our commitment to live life in Christ by blessing ourselves with the newly blessed water, and then we invite all of you to approach the font and also renew your baptismal commitment by blessing yourself in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite forward Peg Flahive, our Director of Adult and Family Ministry.
Father, I now call forth Matthew Hoffa with his sponsor, Jessica, who is one with us already in baptism, and now asks to be received into the Catholic Church.
Matthew, of your own free will, you have asked to be received into full communion with our Catholic Church. You have made your decision after careful thought under the guidance of the Holy Spirit. I now invite you, along with your sponsor, and in the presence of this community of believers, to profess our Catholic faith. In this faith, you will be one with us for the first time at the Eucharistic table of our Lord Jesus, the sign of our church's unity. And so, Matthew, for your profession of faith, please respond after me. I believe and profess.
I believe and profess.
All that the Holy Catholic Church,
all that the Holy Catholic Church
believes, teaches, and proclaims,
believes, teaches, and proclaims
to be revealed by God.
To be revealed by God.
Matthew, the Lord receives you into the Catholic Church. His loving kindness has led you here so that in the unity of the Holy Spirit, you may have full communion with us in the faith that you have professed in the presence of this faith community. By your baptism, Matthew, you have been born again in Christ and have become a member of Christ and his priestly people. Now you are to share in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit among us, the Spirit sent by the Lord upon the apostles at Pentecost and given by them and their successors to all of the baptized. The promised strength of the Holy Spirit, which you are to receive, will make you more like Christ and help you to be a witness to his suffering, death, and resurrection. It will strengthen you to be an active member of the church and to build up the body of Christ in faith and love. My dear friends, in baptism, God our Father gave the new birth of eternal life to his chosen sons and daughters. We now pray to our Father that he will pour out the Holy Spirit to strengthen Matthew and anoint him to be more like Christ, the Son of God. And as I quietly place my hands on Matthew's head with the traditional gesture of imparting of the Holy Spirit, I invite you to extend hands of blessing toward him and pray that he be filled with the Holy Spirit. All-powerful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, by water and the Holy Spirit, you freed your sons and daughters from sin and gave them new life. Send your Holy Spirit upon Matthew to be his helper and guide. Give him the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of right judgment and courage, the spirit of knowledge and reverence. Fill Matthew with the spirit of wonder and awe in your presence. For we make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Matthew, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you, Matthew.
Peace be with you.
Together, let's show our welcome and congratulations. Page 17. Then let's be seated.
Thank you.
Pray, friends, that these are gifts, the many gifts of Easter, may all be acceptable to God, our loving Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all God's holy church.
Amen. Accept, we ask, O Lord, the prayers of your people with the sacrificial offerings, that what has begun in the Paschal mysteries may, by the working of your power, bring us to the healing of eternity through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this night, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sin of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death. By rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts your praise. Even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Jerome, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
With the words Jesus left us, we pray that this Easter season might further God's reign in this world.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And may the peace of the risen Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. And let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
And just a reminder to everyone that in this Easter liturgy, we are keeping in our prayer in a special way Stephanie and John Vodalek. Behold the Lamb of God, broken, poured out for us all. Blessed are we called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy.
May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
I invite forward the ministers of communion for the homebound. We're very grateful for your willingness to bring the Eucharist to those who can't be here to help them be renewed in their life in Christ this Easter. And so we send you with our prayer for them. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Good evening. Our pulpit announcements are as follows. Anointing of the sick will take place at all masses next weekend, April 6th and 7th. Members of the Health Ministry Committee will be available in the gathering space before all masses to make out name tags for those who want to be anointed. Next weekend will also be fellowship, and families with last names beginning with G through K are asked to bring treats to share. Also, the trailer for the aluminum cam drive will be on the north side of the parking lot next weekend. Monies raised by this ongoing fundraiser are used in support of our wonderful mission trip. See the bulletin and website for more information about activities and events here at St. James.
Let us pray.
Bow your heads as we pray for God's blessing.
Please respond amen to the prayers of blessing. May Almighty God bless you through today's Easter solemnity and in his compassion defend you from every assault.
Amen. Amen.
And may he who restores you to eternal life in the resurrection of his only Son endow you with the prize of immortality.
Amen. Amen.
Now that the days of the Lord's Passion have drawn to a close, may you who celebrate the gladness of the Paschal Feast come with Christ's help and exalting in spirit to those feasts that are celebrated in eternal joy.
Amen. Amen.
May Almighty God bless us all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended.